Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Roorkee. So I'll give a very brief introduction about our expert. So on behalf of the college management and the FDP organizing committee, so with great pleasure, I'm happy to introduce Dr. Balasubramanian sir, Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Roorkee, one of the eminent academicians from our country, to lead the session today in this third day of FDP on data science using Python. So sir is currently leading machine vision lab in IIT Roorkee, where many active works are going on medical imaging, texture recognition, activity recognition, and 3D image reconstructions, and many more activities. Sir is presently the recipient of Boys Caste Fellowship, which is awarded by DST, Government of India. Sir is also a recipient of Outstanding Teacher Award in 2010 and 2020, awarded by IIT Roorkee on the occasion of Teachers' Day. So sir has held many visiting positions in many eminent universities across the globe, like National University of Singapore, University Science Malaysia, and Multimedia University in University of Albany, State University of New York, USA. And sir is also currently a guest professor and visiting researcher at Institute for Document Analysis Knowledge Science in Osaka Prefecture University, Japan. So there are many more, which sir is also involved with many other universities like International Christian University, Tokyo, and University Degli Studi di Milano in Italy, and in Institute of Electronics and Telecommunication of Rennes in France. So sir, we are very happy to have you here, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Veeramanikam.
Thank you.
So should I start?
Yeah, please, sir.
So my slides are visible?
Yes, sir. They are visible, sir.
Yeah. So I request all of the participants to mute the mic. So there is a background noise.
Sir, is it okay, sir? So I have muted those participants, sir. Even I'll be also on mute, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, yes, sir.
So good evening, all. I thank Dr. Nagendra to give me this opportunity for this workshop. So the title of my talk is, so you are learning Python, but after learning the language, right? So where you can use this programming in machine learning or deep learning in the areas of computer vision and image processing. So I'm Balasubramanian, professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at IIT Roorkee. So before going there, So organization of my lecture goes like this. So we'll see the basic introduction on machine learning first. So, and then we will see how the machine learning is going to applicable in the areas of brain computer interface, human action recognition, sign language recognition. And then we will see some deep learning applications, and finally end my talk with the privacy preserving human action recognition, where the concept of both cloud and deep learning, right, deep convolutional neural network, are applicable. So as you know, right, the learning theory you can divide into supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So in the case of a supervised learning, suppose, I think during my inaugural talk, I told, suppose a robo is there, right? And then you have been provided a truck of fruits, right? So you are annotating or you are training the robo in such a way that, right? Assume that 70% of the fruits, for example, banana, apple, orange, right? With the help of futures, all right, banana, you have, yellow in color or green in color, right? The shape is, which is completely different from orange. So we are training with the features, right? We are training the robo with the features. So assume that 70% of the fruits, right? The different types of fruits, orange, apple, mango, everything we are, right? Giving the annotation, right? Giving the features, giving the information. So then remaining 30% of the fruits, right? We are checking, right? We are testing, right? So we have trained the robo with 70% and we are testing now. So with the help of the features, the robo can classify, right? So this is called as a supervised learning. Whereas in the case of unsupervised learning, assume that robo is there, trucks of fruit is there. We are not giving any training, right? We are not giving any information. We are not annotating. Now, can the robo classify the fruits? So we call it as unsupervised learning. Similarly, we have a reinforcement learning, right? As I already told during my inaugural talk, learning a bicycle. So when you're learning a bicycle, you will either fall down or at one point of time, you will pedal well. Right, so initially you will fall down, whoever is learning, right, at least one or two times you have to fall down. So falling down is considered as a punishment, and then let us say after 2-3 days you will pedal well, so people will start appreciating, so that means it's a gift. All right, so in the two processes, one is the punishment and the second one is a gift, so you will start doing, or in fact, you will start learning bicycle. So this is a reinforcement learning, right? So machine learning algorithms will fall under, or deep learning algorithms will fall under one of these. So either it's a supervised or supervised or unsupervised, or the reinforcement learning. So most of the problems here, I'm going to talk about the supervised learning. And if you come up with any unsupervised, for example, in the ATM machine, somebody is, right, stealing and running away. All right, so can your camera detects automatically and send the signal? So which is called as unsupervised learning. Or in the airport, somebody is dropping the bag and go, right? Suddenly, this is happening. The incident that you are not expecting, it's happening, but can your machine finds? Right, so we call this as unsupervised learning. So the human learning. Right, so initially, right, let us assume that nine months old baby or 1 year old baby, the mother used to train the faces. Right, so we learn the face recognition problem. So initially, one and a half years, right, the baby used to learn. And then, right, it started differentiating father, brother, sister, all the faces. Assume that at the age of 10 or even 15 or 20, automatically we will recognize the faces. So one time if you see, okay, we know that. Right, so imagine how our human learning is turning from supervised to unsupervised. So this is a perfect example of a supervised and unsupervised. Right, so we will see some of the applications. Right, the first one, I start with the brain computer interface. Assume that I am in a smart room, right? So nowadays you can control either your AC or a TV or a light by a remote, correct? So assume that I'm entering this room and I'm thinking, so the present temperature is 27, can I change the temperature to 23? Right, I'm just thinking. Similarly, I want to change a channel, let us say sports to cinema, or let us say I want to switch on only one light out of the four lights. All right, so these just I'm thinking, right? So from the brain, there may be a signal, right? The one-dimensional data, I talked about the one-dimensional data, right? It is an analog form, it is a, yes, any doubt? So it's of the one-dimensional data, right? So for example, I'm thinking, right? So can my thought will go as a signal, all right? Assume that there is a possibility that we can capture the signal by some machine. And then let us assume that the signal, analog signal B is being converted into digital signal. So from this digital signal, can I infer something, right? You might have thought, I want to change the AC temperature 27 to 23, or I want to change the channel in the TV, right? Or assume that in the right now, in the Google or Gmail, suppose you are getting an email, so you have an option, right? Three options. For example, assume that you want to, your HOD is sending an email for attending the meeting at 4 o'clock. So you know that you are in this lecture, right? So you know that you cannot attend. You are just thinking, right? So right now Google has an option, three options. Yes, I am attending the meeting. I will not attend the meeting, or I may attend the meeting. Something like that in the reply, and then you can go further. So now assume that, right? A machine can find out what exactly you are thinking about this email, right? So can this automatically go? So some signal will be emitted from the brain. So can this signal, right? So you are observing the signal by a machine, analog, which will be converted into digital. And what exactly you are thinking? I am not going to attend the meeting. Assume that. So can this go as an email, right? So all the things are possible in the future. Let us say around 5 to 10 years lane, there is a possibility. So how it is possible? So you have a device called electroencephalogram, EEG, right? So this EEG device, we can place in the head or skull, right? The human skull. So now you can see the electrodes, the 14 electrodes that you are seeing here, right? Which are round in shape, which are circle in shape, and the brain is divided into four parts, right? So these four parts and the green in color is responsible to acquire the signal from the brain, right? So once you get the signal, right? So the analog signal, which will be converted to digital, exactly like an ECG, right? Most of you might have seen the ECG signal or any movies you can find, right? If the person is not well, there is a problem in the heart, right? The ECG, electrocardiograph, is responsible to, right? Responsible, electrocardiograph is responsible to find out whether the person is, for persons that are hot, beat is perfect or not, right? So in this case, so assume that, right? So your brain is also divided. You know, the heart is divided into four parts, right? And then the signal is being generated and it will be converted into digital, and the digital screen you are seeing. So the doctors are seeing whether the patient is, right? The heart pumping of the heart is good or not. So in a similar way, the EEG, the electroencephalogram, is responsible for taking the signal from the person, user, right? The brain signal. So now you can see various EEG devices. So these are all the EEG devices, right? So we are generating, we are getting one-dimensional data, not generating, getting one-dimensional data. So assume that I'm offering you a suite, right? So two persons are there. Assume that a person may like or may not like, right? A person who is not having any diabetes, he will like. Whereas the person is having diabetes, he may not like. Correct? So you can see the EEG devices here, right? The circle in shape, they are nothing but the electrodes, correct? So these electrodes are responsible to get the signal, right? What exactly we are thinking? For example, I like the switch. What signal will be generated? Or assume that I am by mistake I am putting my hand in 100 degrees Celsius water, right? So you know that immediately you have to take out your finger. So where exactly the signal comes from? The signal is coming from the brain, right? So in fact, it's coming in a fraction of second, right? Within a fraction of second, the signal is coming from the brain to your fingertip, and then you are removing if by mistake you're touching 100 degrees Celsius water, right? What exactly it is sending? So now my idea is what exactly the signal is, right? What exact signal it is being sent? And then, for example, if I'm touching the lukewarm water or the cold water, right? Or ordinary water, tap water, right? So nothing will happen, right? I will not take out my hand immediately. Whereas if I touch 100 degrees Celsius water, what is prompting you to take out, right? So the brain is sending the signal. How this signal is differing from where you are touching the ordinary water, right? So these analyses we can make, all right? So in our lab, we have the device called EEG, right? So where you have, you are first initially getting the analog signal. The analog signal, the software will convert into the digital, right? So the one we had seen previously, so this is 14 channels. So you can see 14 electrodes here. Whereas presently we have the system, we can make from 32 to 160. Imagine 14 channels, you are getting the signal. So here 32 channels up to 160 channels, right? So the increase in number of electrodes, you will get the result, you will get the output very nicely, right? The signal, if you are increasing the number of electrodes, the signal will be good, right? That is what the idea. So we'll see some of the problems, what, right? Some of the applications. So prediction of advertisement. For example, assume that you are given 20 YouTube songs, right? The list of 20 YouTube songs, and your job is to find out the rank, right? Which song is the best that goes rank number one, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? Assume that you have 10 different songs, 20 different songs. I want the ranking. So usually what will you do? You take the feedback from the user, right? Assume that there are 5 parameters: excellent, very good, good, fair, and poor. So accordingly you are doing the ranking, right? All these 5 parameters, I am doing the ranking, right? So once you have the 5 parameters in your hand, you can obviously, right, with the help of the statistical learning or any machine learning algorithm, will give you. This is called sentiment analysis problem. So here, apart from sentiment analysis, we also use the electroencephalogram response, EEG response, right? The same user. So assume that the user is like this, and he or she is listening or hearing the songs, correct? So now I'm going to take out the data, both the data. One is a sentiment analysis. The same user is going to respond, is giving the response, right? Assume that we are taking whether it is a song is excellent, very good, is ticking, as well as we are placing the EEG apparatus in the in his scalp, and then it is going to generate the data, right? So we are going to have two different data. We call it as a multimodal data, correct? It is like in the election, we use both EVM electro voting machine as well as electronic voting machine as well as ballot paper, right? What is the advantage? So you can always cross check. One will work as a ground truth, right? How far you are right. For example, the person who is going to vote, assume that he is going to give a vote both in the machine as well as the ballot paper. Right, both in the machine as well as the ballot paper. So what will be the output? I mean, in the ballot paper, assume that we are counting, and then we can always cross-check, right, whether whatever the information we got in the ballot paper is tallying, is matching, right, with the electronic voting machine. In a similar way, so here the same user is giving the response. We call it as a sentiment analysis. And for the same user, we are taking the EEG, the brain signal, and let us see, right? So we combine both the model, or we can keep the sentiment analysis data as a ground truth, and we can check our algorithm in the case of electroencephalogram. So now the framework, right? The architecture you can see, assume that the user is seeing the YouTube video. So we have put the EEG apparatus, right? So that will generate the EEG data. So we have to do, the data should be smooth, right? So we have to remove the noise first and extract the features, because I have to train the model, right? Assume that 1,000 users, that I have to train the model for the various cases. The cases are nothing but you are excellent, very good, right? The song may be excellent, very good, etc. Assume that the user is saying, because it's a multimodal, bimodal, all right, the user is saying excellent. So how the electroencephalogram features are, all right, how the signal is. So first we have to train the model for the different cases. Assume that we are extracting the features. After extracting the features, use some regression analysis or machine learning algorithm, right, to classify. Similarly, you have a sentiment analysis data, you have to do the same thing. Same feature extraction and classification you have to do, it will give the output. Now assume that I am getting some W0 into the EEG data plus W1 into, right, sentiment analysis data. So the combination will give you which is the best, right? Which song is the best? So you can have the ranking 1, 2, 3, etc. Right? So it will give the video rating prediction. So this problem is called as a multimodal fusion, right? So you are getting a data from two different sources. One is a EEG, another one is your comments, sentiment, right? Or feedback data. So the feedback data can be used as a ground truth, or the combination, weight into EEG plus another weight into the sentiment analysis or the comment data. So you'll get the output. All right, so the problem is called as a multimodal fusion, and you can see the video rating prediction. So when you are getting the data, right, assume that you're getting the EEG data. The EEG data looks like this, right? So for example, the column C is indicating the rank. Rank means the quality of the data. So rank 2, lower is better. 1, start with 1. 1 is the first rank, the better one, and you're going up to 5, rank 5, which is not very good. So you can see rank 2 data, we are getting more green signal, right? So if you have more green signal, the data is appreciable. So here, the data is based on the 14 channels, right? And you can see rank number 3, rank number 4, you can see the minute green signal, and whereas the row number 2, it's a completely red signal. The signal is not so good. All right, so if I have the data, the row number 4 and 5 in my hand, I can do the better, right? Better, the data is better, I can go for the better prediction, or I can go for the better machine learning algorithms. So now when you're given signal, initially you have to remove the noise. So you call it as a smoothing. So for this various independent component analysis, or moving average filter, and then I am smoothening the image like this, right? So this is of one problem. And so in the case of a sentiment analysis, for example, I have a binary class. The class is positive sentiment and negative sentiment. I have to train the data, right? Extract the features and train the data, and then classify where it goes, whether it is a positive or negative, or if you have five different parameters, excellent, very good, good, fair, and poor. So you train the data, accordingly, the classification will be done. Right, so the combination of sentiment analysis and EEG data give you the ranking of the video songs. Right, so this is one particular application. And similarly, another application. So if you look at the title of this paper, don't just sign, use brain too. Right, the meaning is presently the banking sectors. Right, presently banking sector. Suppose I want to withdraw money, or I want to do some transaction, right? So what you are doing, you are signing and then passing your check, assume that, or anything, any other document, right? So they are cross-checking with the database, where the database is in the form of image. They are just cross-checking your right signature, and if it is getting matched, your transaction will be processed. So assume that somebody may also do my signature, right? Assume that I want to withdraw, let us say 1,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees, something like that. Somebody may also sign. Assume that the document, they got the document, right? So they can also sign, and then there is a possibility that transaction can happen, right? Because you have the signature, and then they verify with the image database, right? So whereas let us assume that one user, you are the user, right? Somebody is your user ID is there, or your user information is there. Somebody is hacking, and then let us assume that they are submitting the document. So chances of getting process is 99.99%, right? So for example, here A is the genuine signature and B is the forged one. Right? So how do ensure, for example, assume that I am withdrawing, let us say, starting from hundreds of rupees, then thousands of rupees, 10,000s of rupees, 100,000s of rupees, or multi-crore, right? So during signature, so these are various cases. Assume that during signature, let us assume that we are taking the EEG signal as well, right? When you are signing, during your signature, assume that I am taking your signature. So let us assume that all the users in the bank, right, all the customers in the bank, we are doing this. We, during signature, we take the EEG signal as well, right? So in that case, so I will extract the features from the signal. I'll separately extract the features from the signal. So it goes like this. For example, assume that your signature is like this. Right, your signature, during signature, you are getting your signal like this. And let us assume that I have to extract the features. To extract the features, you can use various algorithms. One particular algorithm here you are seeing, it is based on the wavelet transformation, Debussy's wavelet transformation. So in the case of a wavelet transformation, the signal will be divided into approximate part and detailed part. Right, for example, 128 Hz signal will be divided into two, 64 64. The first is 0 to 63 you call it as approximation, and the rest you call it as a detail. Similarly, again the approximate signals will be further divided, again approximate and detail. So you keep on going, right? So you are seeing level 1, level 2, level 3, etc., level 5. So the signal is of the form alpha, beta, gamma, and theta, right? All the approximate part I take, let us assume that they are alpha, beta, gamma, theta. They are nothing but wavelet coefficients. They are the features. For example, if I want to, right, I'll go back to that robo and fruit story. All right. So you are extracting the features. You are giving the information, the features of the fruits. For example, apple, red in color, round in shape, the size is different from grapes. All right, so all these informations you are giving, the size is slightly bigger when you compare to grapes, or let us say lemon, right? So these information, the size, color, texture, all are nothing but features. So when I say red in color, round in shape, I mean spherical in shape, size is slightly bigger, all these information, if I give, my machine will classify this as a apple, right? In a similar way, when the signal is given like this, right? When you're seeing a signal, the user signal, so I'm extracting the features, alpha, beta, gamma, and theta, right? So this is how you are relating. When a data is given, what is the meaning of future extraction? So now I can talk in terms of these features. When I say yellow in color, let us say cylindrical in shape, right? So and the texture, you are explaining the texture and you can conclude that it is banana. All right, so in a similar way, the futures, I'm going to talk only about the futures of this alpha, beta, gamma, theta, and that will give you whose signature it is. Right? These values will give whose signature, who is the person is. All right, based on the signal, we can find it. Right? That is what the idea. So now when we apply, so after extracting, let us say the features. Once I extract this alpha, beta, gamma during testing, all right, I have to classify, I have to use some classification algorithm. I'll assume that 10,000 users are there. All right, so we have to classify, this is one of the person, who is that? So you need a classification algorithm. For example, I have a brain signal, I use discrete wavelet transformation for future extraction. And second thing, hidden Markov model for classification. Similarly, I have a signature data. Signature is in the form of image. So I use pyramidal histogram of gradient, PHOG, right, with the hidden Markov model for classification. Right, again, this will be a bimodal problem, right? You can use it as a bimodal problem. Whatever the data that you are getting, whatever score that you are getting based on the signature, right? So the signature data will be multiplied with the weight W0, and the brain signal data will be multiplied with W1. You add both. So whichever score is higher, the matching of the signature, matching of the person. All right. Or sometimes you can use it if the signature is completely right, same. Right, both are completely same, absolutely same, right? So we have to distinguish whether the person is same or not. Somebody may do my signature, right? My signature, and some hacker is doing my signature, right? Assume that if it is matching, right? So we will go for the brain signal. So the signature itself is not matching. Both are completely different. Right, both are completely different. In that case, I no need to go for the brain signal. The signature itself is completely different. Okay, I'll stop my algorithm here. I don't want to go for the bimodal. Right, the problem is, suppose the signature, both the signatures are same, and then you have a doubt or you want to cross verify, so then you go for the brain signal. Right, so here we can see some examples. So we tested with the 70 subjects of a different age group. And you can see the number of participants, right? And then you can see the first person is a genuine, right? The row A is genuine, the row B, whereas not genuine, right? Forged one. So assume that 80% of the signature is matching or 90% of the signature is matching. But if you look at the brain signal, it is completely different. Similarly, C is the genuine, D is forged. So like this, suppose you have several users, 10,000 users, is it possible to use the bimodal problem? So that is what the idea of using the classical machine learning problem, right? Pyramidal histogram of gradient with the hidden Markov model for the case of, right, image, and the case of signature, we use a wavelet plus hidden Markov model. At one point of time, we get, right, 98.24%. accuracy, right? So this is the advantage of these algorithms, right? So this is the brain computer interface, right? So this I have given some applications. So you can think of, there are several applications, right? So if you have any questions, so I can take, maybe you can unmute your mic. So organizer is here.
Yeah.
Yeah, participants.
Yeah. So up to this brain computer interface, if you have any questions, I will be happily to answer. Right. Otherwise, we will go to the next session. Next section.
Participants, please, if you have any questions, you can please ask.
So I talked about the brain computer interface. Right. So this will be in the future. All right. Sir. So for example, right now we are using the it's a wired one. So there are wireless. And after some stage, let us say 5 to 10 years or 15 years, you will it will be like a chip, right? You can place it in your mobile, and whenever you are getting some information, for example, WhatsApp, you are getting some WhatsApp message, right? You are thinking, you are just want to answer whether you are going to attend the class. You are thinking, I am not going to attend, right? So you are thinking. So can it go as a reply, right? So these are all the future trend, right? So if you don't have any questions right now, we'll go to the next session, next section. Sorry.
Yeah, any questions? Yeah. I think we'll go ahead.
Yeah, we'll go to the next section. Yes, so the next section is of human action or activity recognition. All right. So nowadays you have a lot of cameras, CCTV cameras. So you will get a data. So from the data, I want to go for the human activity or activity recognition, and human action or human activity recognition. So for example, you are seeing a RGB video. So in the RGB video, a person is throwing the ball, another person is hitting the ball, another person is doing some fielding kind of. And you are also seeing a data, depth map data. Right, so you are seeing some structure, a person is there, but you are not able to view anything, his face is not very visible, right? You can see such data as the depth data. And the third one is the infrared data, right? Suppose during night some actions are happening, right? Or night vision, you are capturing using night vision camera some information. So these are all called the video data, right? The video data, in the sense, as I said in the during my inaugural talk, it is a three-dimensional data, right? For example, in a second you have an image followed by, let us say, 80 frames. That means 80 images in a second, right? For you, when I'm looking the video in a second, there are 80 or 100 images. You call it as 80 frames per second or 100 frames per second. The frames are nothing but the images. Imagine if you're given 30 minutes video, the data is huge. Assume that a CCTV footage, one day, one full day, all right, something is happening and I'm asking you to find it. For example, I am appearing. Assume that I am appearing five times and you are given the CCTV footage. Right? So let us say the CCTV footage as a 1 full day, 24 hours video. But I am appearing only 5 or 6 times. So I am giving this problem to you. Okay, find out. So what, you have to spend 24 hours at least, right? Or you may have to take 2 days, 3 days to complete these 24 hours video. All right. And then the task is, I am appearing 5 or 6 times in the frame. Right, in five frames I am appearing. So I am asking you to find out the time, right? So discrete, you have to find out these times I am appearing. So if I assign this particular work, it will take huge amount of time, right? The question is now, can we automate this, right? Assume that I am training the model. For example, in a video, the person is throwing the ball or hitting the ball, right? The second person is like hitting the ball, right? So assume that I'm training my model, hitting the ball, various cases, right? Whether it's a tennis, you are going to hit the ball, or it's a cricket, you are going to hit the ball. I'm training my machine. So these are all called as hitting the ball. So I'm training, right, my machine with the help of some, let us say, available data set. Then the video will be there. Video will be as an input. I'm going to test it. So what are all the frames? I am going to get the output. Right? So the data, it's a very big data. Right? The video data, one day data, assume that you are given, it's a big multimedia data. Right? And then you have to design some algorithm. Right? You have to train the model first and design the algorithm to get the class labels. So these are all the levels of human activities. For example, somebody is doing gesture and somebody is hitting the ball, right? It's action, or walking or waving. They call it as an action. The human-human interaction, two persons are shaking the hand, or human-object interaction, right? Texting is a human-object interaction, or group, right? For example, few people are fighting, or somebody is stealing money in the ATM, right? So these are all called as a group activity. So we divide gesture, action, interaction, and group activity. So video data, assume that's a three-dimensional video data, right? Three-dimensional in the sense, number of frames are considered as third dimension. You have an image, number of frames, right? So three-dimensional data, right? So what are the problems you can solve? Assume that you are given a parking lot, right? The parking, you are given, let us say, 12 different CCTV footage. Assume that 4 days video. 4 days means 96 hours video I am giving, and moreover, 12 different camera views. Imagine the size of, it's a very big size, right? That this data you are going to handle. So now problem is, I have to do some human action recognition. Human action in the sense, people may walk, people may run, people may fight, right? So can you classify these actions? I mean to say, can you find out the frames where the persons are walking? All right? So initially, when you are given the video data like this, first you have to get the background subtraction, like right, from these 12 images, you are getting the common area, mosaicing. This is called the image mosaicing, right? So the meaning is, for example, a Google map. Google map is not a single image. Several images are being stretched together, all right? And then you can see that, right, the common area will look like this. So now in this common area, what are all the different activities go? Right, for example, here people are walking. All right, so how do I extract? Right, for example, suppose I am extracting this particular frame, and then I am giving like the people are walking. Right, I am getting the region of interest for people are walking. Right, so for example, you have a I'll just use the mathematical expressions. All right. So for example, if I consider a frame, all right, in a frame, let us say I am focusing on the points, one pixel position, X comma Y. All right, I'm considering X comma Y. So in frame, let us say I consider ith frame. Right, let us consider I am considering the ith frame. Right, so in the ith frame, at a point x comma y, all right, so I have the gray level value f of xy. So assume that it's a color image. Assume that. All right. For example, the person who is walking wears a red color t-shirt, right? In this particular point, assume that the person is having the red color t-shirt. So the functional value, right, f of xy value will be, let us say, 255.00. This stands for RGB, red, green, blue. So the same person, right, so the same frame or same scenario when you consider the I plus one frame. Suppose the person is moving out of the frame, moving out of the ith frame. When you reach I plus one frame, the person may move, right? Some minute distance because it's the next frame only. Right? So the next frame you may have, this particular point may have green in color because the background grass is green. Alright? So the vector value may change 0, 255, 0. Again for RGB. It becomes, in this particular frame, the same position x comma y, right? So this may change to 0, 255, 0. Possible, right? So now, if I subtract, right, component wise, when I subtract, so I may get the result and 255 minus 255 and 0. Right, I'm just subtracting from year to year. Position vector, I am subtracting here. So when I calculate the norm of this vector, let us say the point is P1, assume that. Alright, so here, so when I calculate as a vector, so for example, modulus of 255 squared plus minus modulus of 255 squared plus 0 squared, which is a non-zero value. Whereas suppose I consider a point in the car, right? Assume that I'm considering a point in the car, both ith frame and I plus oneth frame, they are going to be same. When you subtract, you will get 0, 0, 0. That means norm of the vector is 0. So that means static point, you are getting 0. Dynamic point, you are getting non-zero. Right? For example, this vector 255 minus 255, 0. Looks like 1 minus 1, 0. Alright? So when I compute the modulus or the norm, it will be non-zero. So you are getting, so for this case, you are having the white in color, they are nothing but the region of interest. So this white color, you will have non-zero values, right? When you compute this, the vectors will be non-zero. Whereas the black in color, this particular pixel position, you are having zero because this frame, they are the static. For example, this, the same right here. These are static. There will be no change. Whereas in the dynamic object, there will be a change. Right? So the algorithm is called optical flow algorithm, finding out the optical flow. Right? So this is nothing but the vector generation. So based on the vector, you are finding out, right, whenever you are subtracting. Right? So you are doing some advanced level mathematics and then you are coming up with the region of interest. This is called the region of interest. The region of interest is nothing but you are finding out the dynamic data, right? The dynamic objects, right? That is what the idea of this work, right? So you use some optical flow algorithm to find out these dynamic objects, right? So once I find the region of interest, right? Assume that I am finding out the region of interest. All right, so once I have this region of interest, so now you have the black and white image, you call it as the blob. I simply call it as a blob. Blob is nothing but the binary image. The binary image that we have generated in the last slide. So now I am going to select certain features. I don't want to use the complete object. All right, assume that I don't want to use the complete object. So I want to use some partial. Right, partial in the sense I am going to find out the skeleton of the object, skeleton of this image. So skeleton look like this. So whereas this holds the topological property of this particular image, that is the meaning. So for example, our skeleton, our body skeleton. So if suppose I am doing a scaling or translation and rotation, my whole body will also have, right? That is called as a topological property. So from the skeleton, I am going to extract certain features. For example, here you have a walking sequence. A person is walking in the video. All right, I'm going to extract the features for the walking sequence. So from the skeleton, I'm going to extract the features. Right, assume that you have various classes, walking, running, two arm up, single arm up, right? So now the idea is, whatever the features you are extracting, I have to classify this. So in order to classify, we have to use some classification algorithm like a SVM tree, LDA tree, neural network, right? So then the action is being established. Right, this is what the human action recognition. So now, how to extract the skeleton? So we have used our own work. So what we have done for the case of 3D objects, so here we are going to do for the 2D images, right? So in the case of a 2D images, for example, assume that you know the image is of form f of xy. All right, the image is of the form f of xy. So given f of xy, what I am going to do, I am going to differentiate partially with respect to x and partially with respect to y. Right, we call it as a fx, f suffix x, and this is your f suffix y. Right, the same m. Right, so now I write it in vector form. Your fx I plus fy j, right, same m. Right, I form the force vector. So when I represent this f, right, the f vector, it will look like this. Right, this is nothing but the Newtonian potential. Now, if you look, I have to extract this line segment, the curve line segment. Right, it goes like this. Right, I have to extract this. How I am going to extract? So that is the problem. Right, so how we are going to find out this? That will be the problem. Right, so you are seeing the pattern. So this pattern we have to extract. Right, so for example, if I consider a point here, from five different directions, the vectors are converging. Vector from this direction, vector from this, here, third, and this is your fourth, and this is your fifth. Similarly, if I consider a point here, one in this direction, another one in the opposite direction. Right? They are converging. Right? So how to find out this? That is the problem. Once I find this, so I'll find out based on extracting these points. In the literature, you call it as a critical point, right? So there are points here and here. So likewise, you are finding. So once you find out, you are going to join all these points, right? So then you call this problem as skeletonization problem. I'm going to extract the skeleton, right? Assume that in this way, by finding the Newtonian potential, I can extract the skeleton. Right? So then, where is the application? Once you extract the skeleton, assume that I have extracted the skeleton. Right? So once you extract the skeleton, we use the bounding box. The bounding box is nothing but the ellipse. So we use a bounding box. The bounding box is nothing but the ellipse. And you can see here, right, how it works, right? So we are using here, right? It is the bounding box is nothing but the ellipse. So now this ellipse is divided into n different sectors, right? So you can find n different sectors and assume that you consider second sector. So second sector, you can find the number of pixels, right? Whatever the black portion is there, you find out the number of pixels and divide this with the total number of pixels. Right? So when I divide the total, for example, here, assume that you are in the jth frame. let us assume that you are in the jth frame. All right, so I use the laser pointer. So assume that you are in the jth frame. And here F2J stands for the number of pixels in the second sector. When it is divided by the total number of pixels in the skeleton, your future vector, right, for different sectors, 1, 2, 3, etc., up to n or n number of sectors, and Fj stands for the future vector for the jth frame. Right? For r consecutive frames, you have 1, 2, 3, etc., up to r. For r consecutive frames, you write this is future vector. This is nothing but future vector. Right? I hope it is clear. So, for example, if it is a walking sequence, you extract the future vector F. Running sequence, another future vector F. Right? People are fighting. So, right, these are all the different actions in the video, and you are extracting the features. It is like extracting the features from banana, extracting the future from the grapes, apple, etc. Once you extract the features, right, during training, I am extracting, and during testing also, you have to extract the features. Now, you have to classify which class it belongs to. So for this, assume that we use the linear discriminant analysis, right? Here we are going to see how this linear discriminant binary class problem is going to one of the feature extraction algorithm. Right, one of the feature extraction algorithms, binary, for binary class problem, how you are going to use the linear LDA, linear discriminant analysis. Right, suppose you have two set of points. One is the red point, another is the blue points. Red points and blue points. I have to classify this. Right, so here red is represented as a dot and blue represented as the square. Or rectangle, whatever you say. So assume that you have two different classes, W1, omega 1, and omega 2. And in omega 1, x1 is represented, right? Let us say 4 2 2 4, right? All the points, for example, this point is nothing but 4 comma 2, this point is 4 comma 4, and this point is 2 comma 3. So all the points I classify this as capital X1, and the second class, blue class, classified as capital X2. Right, or you call it as omega 2, right? Omega 2 is nothing but capital X2. Capital X2, the points are like this, right? So you have 0.9 comma 10, in fact 6 comma 8, 9 comma 5, right? All the points are there. There should be one point here, 9 comma 10, right? So assume that you have blue points and red points. Keep it as X1 and X2. So now, you know binary class problem. For example, here you have chest X-ray images, right? So in the left image, the person is suffering from COVID. In the right image, the person is suffering from COVID-19, whereas the left one is normal. So how do you classify for a human learning? So the left side, the person, the bones are visible. The lungs are visible, right? Very less number of cloudy areas. Whereas in the right hand side, the person whose bones are not completely visible. So there is a problem in the problem of visualizing the right lungs. Also a lot of cloudy, right? So whatever I said is nothing but the features. So you have extracted the features and you are telling the left hand side is normal and right hand side is suffering from COVID-19. All right. So imagine I am training, let us say 100,000 images, 100,000 X-ray images for my machine. So one I am saying normal patient, another I am saying COVID-19. So that means I am feeding, let us say 70,000 images, 70% of the data, right? I am training. I am giving a training. So that means my machine will learn, right? When these features are there, the person is normal. When there are features like the bone is not visible, cloudy, and lungs are not visible, so these features are COVID-19. So this is the binary class. This is an example of a binary classification, right? So those who are interested, you can download the image. In fact, I'll share the slides. So you can download the X-ray images here and you can do further analysis. Right? So now going back to the problem. So given X1 and X2, right? So given this X1 and X2, first I am computing the mean value, mu1 and mu2 for both the data. Right? So once you compute mu1 and mu2, you have. So mu1 value and mu2 value, they are nothing but the mean. So once you have computed the mean, all right, I will go for the covariance matrix. It is nothing but the summation of x minus mu1 into x minus mu1 the transpose. Right, you are getting 2x2 matrix, which is called as a covariance matrix. And next case, all right, the second class, again, we are computing the covariance matrix. This is for the first class. And this is for the second class, the covariance matrix. So once you find out the covariance matrices, S1 and S2, right? So now I am adding both. If I add S1 and S2, I will get the within class scatter matrix, SW. Right? SW is simply adding S1 and S2, which is not very difficult. Once you have the matrices S1 and S2, you are simply adding, and you call this as within class scatter matrix. And in the case of a second, I want to compute this between class scatter. The between class scatter is nothing but the multiplication of the subtraction of the mean, mu1 minus mu2 into mu1 minus mu2, the whole transpose. The resultant is nothing but SB, which is nothing but the between class scatter matrix. All right. So once you get this, I want to compute the eigenvalues for the matrix SW inverse SB. So you have already computed, right, SB and SW, right? So now SW inverse into SB. We will see why I am calculating the eigenvalues for SW inverse into SB, right? I will go to the theory part. Here I am showing with the help of example. Once you go to the theory part, you will understand, right? So now forget at this moment why we are calculating SW inverse in SB. But when you calculate the eigenvalues, two eigenvalues, right? So 2x2 matrix, the eigenvalues are one lambda is 0, another lambda is 12.200. So now I am finding out the corresponding eigenvectors. Right? For this eigenvalue, you have the corresponding eigenvectors. For 0, you have eigenvector W1, and for 12.2007, eigenvector is W2. Correct? Or one can find directly. Directly, for the largest eigenvalues, the corresponding eigenvector is this. For example, if you are multiplying SW inverse with mu1 minus mu2, you will get, right, the eigenvector which is corresponding to the largest eigenvalue. Right? So now I plot it. Let us assume that I consider smaller eigenvalue. Right? The smaller eigenvalue, I am finding out the eigenvector. The eigenvector is pink in color. So now I am trying to project the points. Right? For example, red points and blue points, I am trying to project on this pink line. Pink line is nothing but eigenvector which corresponds to the smallest eigenvalue. So now when I project all this and rotate 90 degree, right, make it as a first axis, maybe x axis. So you can see blue points, you can see the red points, right? So in the projection, you are not able to distinguish the classes. The classes were overlapping, the classes are overlapping. And if I draw the Gaussian, you can see it is not a good separability, it's a bad separability. Right, this is because I have chosen the smaller eigenvalues corresponding eigenvector. All right, assume that I am choosing the largest eigenvalue and the corresponding eigenvector. So the green in color, they are nothing but an eigenvector for the largest eigenvalue. And if suppose in this eigenvector, I am projecting all these points. So when I project all these points, and then assume that I am drawing a Gaussian, the Gaussians are clearly separable. Right? This is the example of a good separability. So that means you choose the eigenvector whose eigenvalue are the largest. because the magnitude is higher. Once the magma, the whatever value that you are getting for the eigenvalue, the largest eigenvalue means the largest magnitude vector. Right. So therefore, when I am projecting all these points, you can find, right, the good separability. I am using, let us assume that I am drawing a Gaussian curve. Right. So the resultant is the good separability. Right. So this is how your LDA algorithm works. This is nothing but your dimensionality reduction. Dimensionality in the sense from you cannot able to solve the problem in two dimension. I'm projecting in one dimension. For example, in this case, I am projecting all my points in the eigenvector, the green in color. So once I project, assume that I'm projecting here, perpendicularly I'm dropping a line. Right. So I can able to do, when I draw the Gaussian, so you can see the Gaussian, right? This is called as a good separability, right? So now we take, let us say 3 minutes break, 2-3 minutes break.
Yeah, please, sir.
Right,
please,
I'll sir. Take some water and then we will go to the theory of this LD.
Sure, sir.
We have another 50 minutes.
Yes, sir.
The theory of LDA, and then I will focus on the applications point of view in the case of both machine learning and deep learning, right?
Yeah, sure, sir.
So
sure, sir.
You have understood the example part, right? I'll keep the slide here. In the next, we'll go to the theory part. We'll take some 2 minutes, 2-3 minutes break, okay?
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Participants, if you have any questions or any queries regarding this presentation, you can please ask at the end of the day, like end of the session. Or you can raise your hand meanwhile. So I'll be pointing out one by one and I'll be telling the slots.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So we had seen the example of a LDA, right? So now, if we discuss in terms of theory, right? So for example, you have, let us say, four classes, right? So I want to find out the largest eigenvalue and keep that as a, right, the one you are having the eigenvector, the corresponding largest eigenvalues eigenvector, right? So I am dropping the perpendicular. All right, so the direction is nothing but we call it as a vector, magnitude and direction. So that direction, so the direction psi. So the main objective of LDA is to find out the direction psi, right? So in that process, you are maximizing the between class scatter, SB. We calculated SB and SW, if you remember. So here, if you look at the expression is based on the Fisher, right? The Fisher's equation, right? So here, if you look, SB is in the numerator and SW in the denominator. So SW inverse into SB, right? So SW inverse into SB, that is what we are taking here, right? The reason we are taking the eigenvalue SW inverse SB because, right, if you look at the Fisher's equation, SW is in the denominator. All right. So when you compute the direction based on taking the eigenvalue of SW inverse into SB, in fact, I'm calculating the largest eigenvalue and the corresponding eigenvector for this largest eigenvalue is nothing but the direction psi. All right. So we have to maximize JSA. So we compute SB and your SW is adding your individual classes, S1, S2, etc. Right? So once you find SW and SB, all right? So what we have done, you have computed, let us say the eigenvector you have computed, and then you are projecting all these points, right? Dropping a perpendicular for this line, this direction, right? So how far this will be, right? For example, here you are getting the good separability. The red color points and blue color points have been separated, right? But there are cases. So assume that you are working on the millions of classes, right? Millions of classes or billions of points, let us say thousands of classes, right? So you may not always get, right, exactly the separability like this. For example, I may have 95% of the red points, right? 98% of blue points. Whereas some anomaly, right? Some blue points may appear in the red and some red points may appear in the blue. That is what the machine learning algorithm, right? You may not always get 100% accuracy, right? So how to get the accuracy? For example, assume that I have four classes. All right, so the classes are nothing but alpha, let us say beta, and then gamma, and then delta, right? So when I project these in the LDA, using LDA, when I am projecting, I expect, all right, so all the points should be alpha. All right, the points are, let's say, alpha is the one class, like let us say blue points, right? Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, they are nothing but the points, alpha k. All right, but there are some beta j and gamma k possible, or delta z, right? There are possible in this node, right? That means my algorithm works 95%. It can, when I am projecting, 95% alpha points I may get, but remaining 5% may be beta, gamma, delta points possible, right? Similarly, I am projecting these points. Right, 95% I may get beta points. Remaining, all right, anomaly, I may get alpha, gamma, delta points possible. Right, so what I am going to do, I am not going to stop in one iteration. I may grow the tree. right? I mean to say, LDA I have applied, I got the result. Similarly, LDA, if I apply, I will get the result, right? I am not stopping the algorithm. Again, I am going to use LDA, right? In order to increase my accuracy. 95% accuracy I am getting after applying LDA again, all right? So that means the computer science point of view, computer scientist point of view, I am growing the tree till reach the leaf node. So when I reach the leaf node, my point should be alpha. That is what my idea. Or I am increasing my accuracy 95 to let us say 98%. Right? The number of occurrence, maybe it has increased to 98%. Right? I am not able to do further, fine. 2% anomaly you may get. That is always in the machine learning algorithm, you may not always get 100% accuracy. All right? So that means I am growing a tree. So this is a leaf node. So when I am reaching the leaf node, right, I am getting the class. The class is being separated. And similarly, when you are growing for the, let us say, right, other children, right, this is a root node, the other children. So you may end up, let us say, with some leaf, right? So I am continuing my algorithm till reaching the leaf node. On the leaf node, I am getting the classes, right? That is what the idea of this work. Right? I hope you understand. Right? I'll go to the next slide. There are. Now, going back to the problem. So assume that I have, let us assume that I have 9 frames, right? Video analytics problem, I am going back. So I assume that I have 9 frames. So 9 frames are running sequence. The running sequence is like this. And then I am extracting the blob. The blob is a black and white image. And from the blob, I am extracting, let us say, the skeleton. From the skeleton, assume that I have 9 frames and 8 sectors in the ellipse, right? So if I have 9 frames and 8 sectors in the ellipse, totally there will be 72 attributes. So all these attributes, I am, right, let us say, I am plotting the number of pixels. I am normalizing to 0 to 1, number of pixels I am plotting. So now this is going to be your, right, histogram for running sequence, right? This is going to be your histogram for the running sequence. So like, yeah. Can the participant please mute the mic? I'm getting a disturbance. All of you, please mute your mic.
Yeah, I have done that, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
All right, so now for the running sequence, I'm getting the histogram like this. Similarly, for a walking sequence, I'll get the histogram. All right, for all the other actions, I'll get the histogram. Right, so basically this histogram is nothing but future extraction, right? Extracted features. Right, now if I go for the testing case, I will match with this, right? I have applied LDA algorithm, LDA tree algorithm. I use LDA tree algorithm for the classification. That is what the idea, right? So here the virtual human action still out data set, you have, these are the 20 different actions. So you can see running, walking, punching, collapsing, knockout, hero smash, right? Hang on bar, jump from object. All these are all nothing but the different human actions, right? So now, as I said, how to extract the features, assume that we are training our model and then assume that we are extracting the features and then we have to go for the testing. Now, these are the different actions. Assume that we are using 6 different actors with the 12 different camera views, and these are all some of the actions, right? To warm up, sitting posture, right? Running sequence, right? So you have skeleton and the corresponding histograms. The histograms are nothing but the extracted features. So now, assume that you have 20 different actions. Suppose you have, you are using only the single shot LDA. Single shot LDA in the sense, you are running your LDA algorithm only one time, right? For example, you are extracting that eigenvector and then you are plotting it, right? The single shot LDA, there is a chance that a mismatch is more. For example, 20 different classes, you have the mismatches 0 to 5. 0 considered as no mismatch. In one class, class number 10, you have a 5, right, which is slightly more. And whereas if you draw, right, if you construct the LDA tree, right, when you construct LDA tree, you can find that, you can find that your misclassification is very less. Maximum you're getting 2, 0, 1, 2. 0 stands for no misclassification, and 1 is slightly higher, 2 is more, right? But compared to single shot LDA, your LDA tree algorithm is giving better results. So now, this is your mosaic image where you are getting the common parking lot area, and experimentally, if you go, so you are seeing a person is experimental results, right? Testing result, testing case. A person is running, walking, two arm up, single arm up, and then sitting posture. You can extract the blob, and after extracting the blob, you can see the skeletons, right? So from the skeleton, you can extract the histogram. Right, so now, for example, assume that in the case of a walking sequence, right, this is a histogram. So now with the help of a LDA tree, I can classify where it goes, right? So that is what the use of the classification algorithm, right? So this is a testing case. And if you use the LDA tree-based classifier, you can get 98.5% accuracy. For example, sitting posture, actual, and sitting posture during testing, right? So 1.0 is indicating that you are getting 100% accuracy. And 0.98 is indicating that you are getting 98% accuracy, right? So like this you are going. So running, walking, waving, right? 99% accuracy you are getting. And on the whole, right, the proposed approach when you are using, LDA tree-based algorithm, 98.5%, but if you stop your algorithm in the single iteration, you call it as a single shot that produces 95.8% accuracy. I hope it is clear. So now, so can we use the deep learning algorithms? For example, here, okay, so now you can see the University of Texas data set for the human action, all right? Swipe left, swipe right, throw, push, walk, right? So these are all the different actions, the video data set. So we have got this from University of Texas data set. We call it as the University of Texas data set. And then assume that I am going to apply the deep learning algorithm, right? Another famous algorithm we have seen, one application in machine learning. In fact, two applications in machine learning. One is your brain computer interface, and another one is a video analytics problem. Now, if we apply the deep learning model, right? So can we get better results? For example, we use the input modalities like RGB video, gyroscope sensor data. Gyroscope sensor data in the sense that person is wearing some wearable devices like a smartwatch, etc. Right, so that will give you a data, one dimensional data. Similarly, we have seen skeleton, how do you obtain a skeleton? All right, all these data are considered as the input data. So from the video, assume that we can find the stack dense flow difference image. For example, in the previous case, I talked about the optical flow, right? F of xy, I computed, right, the difference when you have that particular frame, what is the color? In the next frame, how the color is changing? then we are subtracting, right? So like this, we find another difference image. We call it as a stack dense flow difference image from the RGB video, right? So we calculate this, right? From the RGB 3D data, video data, so we find this 2D image. Similarly, gyroscope, I said, you person is wearing the watch, right? For example, this person is wearing some wearable device that will give a signal. So swipe left, it is giving a signal. Swipe right is giving a signal. Throwing the ball, it is giving the signal, right? So we consider that as a one-dimensional signal. And then, right, so we use, we are going to use for the skeleton data, we use some recurrent unit. So here in this case, the two-layer bidirectional gated recurrent unit is being trained, right? So we will quickly go into the deep learning model. So this is a deep learning model. For example, this is the input layer. So we use the one-dimensional data. We use the RGB video and calculate the stack dense flow difference image and then skeleton data, right? So they are called as an input layer. This is called as an input layer. And this one, right? So we are training your one-dimensional data separately, two-dimensional data separately, recurrent neural network data separately. So we call this layer as hidden layer, right? And then we will get the output. So since all the dimensions are different, we fuse the data to get the different classes. The classes are nothing but wave, clap, throw, right? All are nothing but the classes. Right, this is nothing but the actions, right? For example, in the video, waving, clapping, throwing, right? So here we have trained the model differently. For example, the one-dimensional data, we use one-dimensional convolutional neural network to train. And for the two-dimensional data, because RGB video, this is an image, the two-dimensional convolutional neural network. So that is being trained. And lastly, the skeletal data, we use recurrent neural network, right? Since the dimensions are different, we have to fuse the data and then we have to get the output. This is the output layer. This is the hidden layer, right? The hidden layer, the future vectors are being generated and this is the output layer, right? So in this case, we are getting accuracy up to 97.91%. Similarly, the multimodal egocentric activity data set. Right. For example, you have, let us say, a person is, assume that a person cannot see this wall, right? So we put a camera in the forehead, right? Let us assume that in the forehead, when the zebra cross is occurring or the person is, right, walking upstairs in the escalator, right? We call this is ambulation. And also, a person is eating or drinking or texting, they call it as a, we call it as a daily activities. Or a person, let us say, is working in the office, right? Office work. Similarly, exercise. So these are all called as a multimodal activity, right? Egocentric activity. Right? Assume that a person is walking in the road, right, where he cannot see this world, right? Some images occurring. For example, burger images occurring, or idli dosa images are occurring. So that means he is near the restaurant, all right? Assume that the camera is automatically connected with his mobile and the mobile is giving some information, right? The vision and language, the problem is called as a vision and language, right? So it is seeing the natural, right, image, right, the nature. It's seeing the nature and based on the image, it is giving the information. Right, so this is the application where the person, suppose assume that the person is not able to see the world, so based on the language, so you can understand, right, the vision and then the language. So the problem is called as a multimodal egocentric activity. So now, like the head mounted cameras, whatever you are capturing, the RGB video is considered as a input, and the wearable devices like a smartwatch, fitness tracker, right? So we are getting the data. These are all from input sources. And also we are calculating, right, the approximate dynamic image and the stack difference image. Because if the video is given, we have to compute this, right? That is called the approximate dynamic image and the stack difference image. And then, right, so when you go for the architecture, so from the video we are computing, you know that you are computing the ADA and SDA, right? So we define ADA is nothing but approximate dynamic image, and SDA is nothing but the stack difference image, all right? So we train the convolutional neural network model, 2D CNN and 3D CNN separately, right? 2D CNN separately for ADA and SDA. CNN stands for convolution neural network. This is happening in the hidden layer, and the one-dimensional data, right? The one-dimensional data we separately train with the one-dimensional convolutional neural network. That means a person, assume that he's having some wearable device, right? Apart from the camera, there are some wearable devices. We have to train this one-dimensional convolutional neural network. So fuse both the data, 1D data and 2D data, get the output. Right, so this work appeared in Indian Conference on Vision Graphics and Image Processing, and the previous work appeared in Journal of Ambient Intelligence and Human Eyes Computing. Right, so this egocentric activity data set, we are getting the output up to 86.5% accuracy. Right, when you are using a deep learning model, you are getting the accuracy up to 86.5%. Right? And similarly, suppose during night, some incident is occurring. Right? So we use some infrared camera. Assume that the infrared cameras are installed. All right? So for example, in our campus, during night, somebody can point the gun or carry the gun or dropping an object or fighting, kicking, pushing, right? All these incidents are happening. So assume that if the camera is capturing these incidents, and automatically can it send to the signal to the security office, right? That is what the idea of this work, all right? So given infrared image, infrared video, we calculated SDFD, I said, stack dense flow difference image, and similarly, the saliency, right? Stacked saliency difference image. Saliency is nothing but the important portion of the object. For example, here, if you're given an image, so these persons are important. So the person is important, right? When you're finding out the important, right, objects from the image, you call it as a saliency, right? So once you compute the saliency, saliency is based on, right, that means once you compute the SDFDI, right, and the saliency difference image, we train your convolutional neural network model separately, right? So you are training your convolutional neural network in the hidden layer, and right, since you are training in a different way, you have to fuse, and then in the output layer, if you see, you will get the output layer, you will get the actions. So this work appeared in Infrared Physics and Technology. So the accuracy, since it's a night vision, accuracy goes up to 75.17%. So far I talked about the human action or human activity recognition. If you want to discuss anything, we'll go ahead. Right, so we'll have some sort of, if you have any questions, participants, if you have any questions. So if you have any questions, unmute your mic, or you take the help from the organizers and they will help you to ask the questions. Yeah,
I think no one is turning left.
Okay. So that means they are understanding my talk very well.
Yes, sir.
So the next topic is, yeah, I have another 25 minutes or even less, 24 minutes. I'll complete. So the next topic is sign language recognition. So assume that, right? So here you have for different A to Z, this is American Sign Language. So you have A to Z and the corresponding signs for this A to Z, right? These are all the different signs for A to Z. So in IIT Roorkee, we have a school called Anushruti, where the students, right, they cannot talk or hear. So in that case, they do some actions. Assume that I'm putting the mobile phone in front of them, what exactly they want to convey, right? So it goes like a text or speech. So whatever actions they are doing, I am putting the mobile in front of them. So can I get the output, speech or text? Similarly, vice versa. I am talking, can it go it as an action, right? So this is called as a sign language recognition. So we have to do some basic pre-processing technique in image processing, and then we have to come up with what exactly the sign language recognition is. So here we have taken the complicated background, where you can see the face color, hand color, and the background almost look like the same color, right? So in these cases, let us assume that I am applying many pre-processing algorithms such as RGB threshold, HSB threshold, and so on. At one point of time, I can able to distinguish my hand color and the face color, right? Similarly, assume that I am extracting, right, the region of interest like this. So once you extract the region of interest, assume that you extracted the region of interest like this. Now I apply, right? I have trained my model. I apply a machine learning algorithm, for example, surf with support vector machine. You get accuracy 68.83. Slightly changing wavelet with SVM, 74%. Right? Instead of using SVM, let us say I use LDA, I get 75.6% and up to 98.83%. All right. So you may ask the question, which is the best feature extraction algorithm or which is the best classification algorithm? In machine learning algorithm, you don't have any best, right? It depends on your applications. In some of the applications, right, LDA may work good. In some of the applications, SVM may work good. In some of the applications, neural network may work good, right? So like this, you go, right? In this case, up to 98.83% we got, and we can say that, all right, this we have done for alphabets. So once you are completing the alphabets, you can go for backup words. And when the words are over, go for sentences, paragraphs, essays. So this is how you learn the language. So in this case, it is a sign language. Right? So this is one of the case where only alphabets are being used, and this is American sign language, that means English. So next we tried with the German finger spelling. Right? In the German finger spelling, unlike your A, B, C up to Z, you have some more also, 35 data set. Right? We have to extract the features. Right? This is a German finger spelling example. And in fact, we have to extract the key points, we have to extract the dense trajectories. All right? So once you extract all these, you have to use the machine learning algorithms such as random forest, support vector machine, classification, etc. Right? For example, this is a data set. You have A to Z, followed by A double dot, O double dot, etc. And then you have some gestures. You call it as a German finger spelling gestures. 35 dynamic. Unlike English, you have 26. Here you have 35 dynamic gestures. Assume that you are applying support vector machine and random forest. You get the accuracy up to 76.4%. Right? For 30 classes, you are getting 76.4. And for 35 classes, you are getting 73.5% accuracy, right? So in the case of a usual machine learning algorithm, you are not getting much accuracy. Whereas, assume that if I use the deep learning model, for example, this is Argentinian sign language dataset, right? So people are wearing some gloves and then they are doing some signs, for green, that is a sign, sweet milk, that is a sign, trap, that is a sign, right? Red, which is a sign, right? So now, when I apply the deep learning model, the input layer has the RGB a depth video, and then for each video, we are calculating the motion history image, dynamic image, RGB motion image, right? We calculate this, and then mobile net convolution neural network is useful to extract the features. And then this model is a combination of deep learning as well as machine learning, right? So we use kernel based extreme learning machine to do the classification. So your architecture goes like this. You have a video, and then I calculate this MHI, DI, RGBMI, that means the template generation. And then I train the model separately, and then extract the features. So here you are using the convolutional net and the KELM classifier. It's a machine learning classifier. So it's a combination of deep learning and machine learning. Right, so this will give a class label. Class label is nothing but different classes. So this work appeared in the Visual Computer. So in the case of Argentinian Sign Language, unlike your traditional machine learning algorithm, here we got 97.81% accuracy. Similarly, we tried out in the case of night vision, right? So during night, some person who cannot able to talk or hear, so he is saying, right? So we have tested with set of words, right? In the previous cases, we have spelling and then some of the words. So you can think of sentences, paragraphs, right? Also, you can think of some Indian languages, Telugu, Tamil, right? Malayalam, Punjabi, Hindi, right? All these languages you can try. So this is like an open problem. Many researchers have not solved. So this go like an open problem. Similarly, so can we use only feature extraction? Assume that I am not using any classification algorithm, right? So can we use only feature extraction, kinship verification problem? Right. So what is kinship verification problem? Suppose two images are given. Right. One is a father, another one is a son, or father and daughter, or mother and son, mother and daughter. If these images are given, so we can always extract the features. Let us say eyes or nose or lips. Right. In this particular case, we considered eyes. So two images are given. It will tell whether they are related in the fashion, father and son. Right, mother and daughter, father and daughter, right? So it is possible. So it is based on only extracting the features, right? Assume that you have the father's image. For example, this is one of my PhD students' work. He took his image and his daughter's image. So you can see the left eye, right? The left eye of the person, extract local ternary pattern. Once you extract the local ternary pattern, calculate the score, right, using some metric learning, right? So match with the score of the daughter, right? The same eye features you are taking, extract the features using a local ternary pattern, and use again the metric learning. So come up with the score. If the scores are matching, for example, father's case, I am getting a score of 85, and the daughter's case almost like a, right, I have to get near 85. 84, 83, or 80, or 90, right? So these are all near match. I am getting the output. All right, I am saying that they are all right related in terms of father and daughter. All right, so the parent image I use as a train image, extract the feature, get the score. And child image is a test image, extract the feature, and go for the matching. Right, based on the score, right? Both the scores, you go for the matching. If, let us say, as I said, for the score, I'm getting 90. Children's score, I expect near 90. Right, I put some threshold, 85, fine. 95 fine. All right. So not only one eye, I will go for left pair and right pair of eyes. All right. So you can think of other features like a nose, right? Lips, texture, right? The texture of a skin, right? With all these features, so my algorithm will tell whether they are related, the kinship relation, whether they are two images are given, let us say father and son's image is given, are they related or not, right? So in the case of one data set, we got the accuracy up to 73.24. In another data set, we got the accuracy up to 77.05. Right, almost the last part of my work, right, talk. So here you can see the human motion generation using deep recurrent neural network. Assume that here you are seeing a pair is dancing. All right. So let us assume that up to 5 minutes, right? Up to 5 minutes, you are getting the video. You are having the video. And from this 5 minutes, assume that you are able to generate the skeleton. Right, 0 to 5 minutes, I'm able to generate the skeleton. Skeletons are nothing but blue in color. So now, here, I'm talking about here, this case. So can I predict the next steps? Let us say 5 to 10 minutes, right? So can I generate the skeleton? From the skeleton, you are always able to reconstruct. Right, so can I generate the red signals? Right, red skeletons like this. Right, so this has got application in the action recognition, surveillance, healthcare, virtual reality. So that means I am predicting. The task is prediction and then you are generating. Right, so we have used aggressive model, auto-regressive model and the graph-based models. So for example, this is the complete architecture, right, with the help of deep learning. So this work is recently appeared in International Conference on Image Processing. For example, somebody, right, the author Zhou et al. Solved with a LSTM method. All right, you can see this is a given skeleton. These are the generated skeleton. If you look at the generated skeleton, the hands and the legs are very wide. All right, so you can see the animation, which is not so good. And we slightly modify with the help of pose embedding. For example, here you have this given skeleton. It was slightly better. Right, so you can see the animation. All right, so they are slightly better. Whereas our proposed algorithm, we use the variational recurrent neural network. So this is a set of given skeleton we have generated. And if you look at the generated animation, right, so they are better. The generated animations are better than the previous two methods. So now once you generate this animation using skeleton, you can always be able to reconstruct the object, right? That is the idea of working with the skeleton, right? So this work appeared in International Conference on Image Processing. And the last part of my work, the combination of cloud and convolutional neural network, right? I talked about the problem of video analytics, right? So when you suppose, I'll just quickly go to that important slide. So here, if you're given image like this, video like this, you can always, right, extract what exactly the person is doing, right? What exactly the recognition is. Assume that you are analyzing my video. I may not like this, right? Assume that you are analyzing my video. I may not like. So somebody is analyzing my video, right? I want some privacy. So assume that I am doing, right? I am blocking. I can make the blocks, right? At one point of time, your image is like this, right? The video is like this. Assume the 30 minutes video is completely like this. This is called as an obfuscated image. So from this obfuscated image, can you do the human action recognition, right? Action recognition, right? From obfuscated images like this. So how do you get the obfuscated image? obfuscated image, so we can play with the pixel. So block by block, we can play with the pixel like this, and then we are getting the obfuscated image, the last column. Or even in this column, you are not able to see the person, right? Or in this case, your original 224 by 224 image look like this, 32 by 32 block size, and the image size is 7 by 7. Right? So many, many videos you can see. For example, if they don't want to see show some person, they make an obfuscated. This is the meaning of obfuscating. So for when a given image is like this, so can you use your mobile net model, right, to train after computing the front, side, and top, and then MHI? So is it possible to train these kind of right video and then get the action recognition? All right. So we have done the combination of the cloud, the concept of cloud, and the convolutional neural network. So this work appeared in Expert Systems with Applications, right? So far I have talked, all right, the various algorithms, starting from the brain-computer interface, and then you have, right, the human action and human activity recognition, sign language recognition, and some of the applications, all right? So if you have any questions, we can discuss now.
Yeah. Participants, showcase your doubts with the professor. Sir is available. Okay, I think.
Yeah, I have put forth the various applications.
Yeah,
not yes, a problem. So yes. Yeah, you can always contact me over here. So we are doing several projects for DRDO, SERB, SMILE, right? And even recently we completed a project for Samsung. And this is my GitHub page for my lab. And this is my website. And this is my email ID. So in case if you have any doubt, you can always send an email to me, and thank you very much.
Sir, thank you, sir, for your knowledge sharing with all of our participants along with me. I request Shanmugam sir to kindly give a vote of thanks.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Good evening, Professor.
Good evening.
So this is Dr. Shanmugam from IT department. Hello.
Am I audible, sir? Yes, Dr. Shanmugam.
Thank you. Sir, really it's a wonderful and informative and innovative session. I hope every participant really enjoyed your session, and they have learned the concept like analyzing the brain signal by using the EEG, and sentiment analysis problem, and listening the songs and give the feedback about the songs in the rate of ranking, and signature verification mechanism by using the brain signal in the banking activity, and many concepts you discussed by using brain computer interfaces, and also human action recognition concept you discussed, sir. This is very informative and very good, actually, by using CCTV footage video and deep learning application like multimodal human action data set you discussed, and multimodal egocentric activity data set applications you given. Mm-hmm. So a lot of innovative and future research technology you discussed so far. So very informative and very good session, sir. Really, thank you very much, sir, for giving your valuable time with us. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind time here, spending with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Veeramanikam, and thank you, Shanmugnathan. I also thank Nagendra.
Sir, thank you, sir.
Okay,
thank you.
I will be leaving, okay?
Sure, sir. Sure.
Thank you, sir.
Participants, the formalities will be again directed to you by through WhatsApp. You please go through the WhatsApp channel so that you will get your necessary feedback links. Thank you. We'll be posting it another 15 minutes. Yeah. Thank you, participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So today's session is
yeah.
Thank you.
Today's session.